I thought I just would start out also just by saying I spent from 18 to 22 in this area, in this city, and so being back here feels it just extremely loaded and moving, because it's where I first fell in love and where I first went to my first gay bathhouse. There's the video showing, no, piece, but you know, not that I'm sort of, I say it jokingly, but seriously, I mean, just experiences of youth, you know, hi there, you're welcome. So it feels incredibly stirring because it's where I first really, it's where I came out. And being in this room feels incredibly, I don't know, it just, you forget when you look up and see Isherwood and Sappho. But I remember how terrified I was. I lived on Market and Sanchez, and across the street was a rowdy gay bar, and there was guys hanging out. I don't know what it was called, but they were on the pad, and I was so afraid of them. And my parents came to visit, and I saw them look across the street, and I was, you know, and I look back, that's only, you know, that's 30 some years ago, and all that sense of being trapped and hidden, and to be back now as a 56-year-old doing these plays, talking, just trying to seek some kind of truth and some kind of transparency about what it is to be human and what it is to try to grow toward some kind of authenticity as a human. I'm expressing this incredible gratitude and sense of how moving it is to be in San Francisco, of all places. And this is where also where I began my serious, was where I came out, and it's where I also said I'm gonna make the decision to really dedicate myself to acting. And I wanted to read, just because I thought it would be fun, from the former book that All the Rage came out recently, but The Tricky Part came out about 10 years ago almost. But I write a little bit about the process of discovering when I was a young person the first sort of sense of being in love with, possibly in love with this bizarre thing called the theater. And now since I'm performing across the street. And I do want to say too, you guys, this is such a bizarre, isn't it, endeavor, this self-chronicling, like that this memoir, what you know, the whole notion of memoir, that stories come from a river of experience rather than completely the land of fiction. And there's such a paradox in that. I don't know if you've ever heard that wonderful Buddhist saying that to study the way is to study, the way is to study the self. To study the self is to forget the self. To forget the self is to allow the 10,000 things to flow. So that bizarre paradox, by focusing on our own stories, cracking through to what is truly, you know, just human and universal, for lack of a better word. And I still have a lot of shame a lot of times about the fact that that seems to be the central thrust of my writing, is this navel-gazing. Like I hear the voice of the priest saying, there you go again, calling attention to yourself, talking about yourself. But it seems that the paradox is, in talking about myself, my hope and my prayer is that I am forgetting about myself, that it's really just talking about us. But hey, for fun, a short passage about tripping upon, I don't know if I know some of you might have, you know, may have read this book, a couple of you have. But maybe I'll give voice to this little moment of being about 16 years old, 17 years old, and tripping upon the theater for the first time. Let's see if we get that. So this is a time in my life when I was had gone through being a sort of sexual initiation, very inappropriate as a kid, an older man at a Catholic camp. And I was really, really struggling with suicidal feelings and shame and isolation. And by some stroke of fate, this event occurred. I was walking through the lobby at school when I noticed a bright orange poster. On it was drawn a large cartoon figure of a hefty man kicking up his heels. He was wearing a toga or something Roman-like and was running, apparently being chased by a scantily clad, large-breasted blonde. His sandals were skimming along large red letters that said, "A funny thing happened on the way to the forum." Below, in the right-hand corner, was printed the following information. Auditions, October 14th. Auditorium, sign up, room 228. Without much thought, I moved through the crush of students, up the stairs, and across the hall to the drama room. My head had the slightest conversation with my feet. "What are you doing?" My body's reply, "This is the way it is." I signed my name on the clipboard hanging near the door. The following week, I sat clutching sheet music for Camelot against my knees, my legs jerking up and down. "This whole thing's absurd," I kept thinking. "I'll never go through with it." There was a row of folding chairs lined up in the hall just outside the entrance to the auditorium. They were all occupied with students like me, holding music, humming softly, appendages jerking. "This is crazy," I kept thinking. "How could anyone do this? Next!" He was pointing at me, this guy with copper-colored hair. "Is that dyed?" I wondered. He was telling me I was next. I stood and, avoiding the eyes of the others folded in their folding chairs, I walked past the boy with flaming hair, through the door, and onto the stage of the enormous auditorium. "Music, please." It was a deep, disembodied voice bubbling up from somewhere. "Down here," it said. I walked forward and saw a guy seated in the orchestra pit behind an upright piano. A white guy with the biggest afro I'd ever seen. A globe of curly black hair topped with a tiny purple yarmulke, held in place, I noticed, with a bobby pin. "Music?" he asked again. I bent down to hand him my song. He stood to take it. His yellow t-shirt cried, "Godspell." "Tempo?" "Fast," I whispered. "Okay." He gestured for me to move back toward center stage. I shuffled back and forth, stuck my hands in my pockets, took them out. I bent my knees to keep them from shaking. "Dive in, baby lamb," came a female voice from amid the dark sea of seats. I squinted and saw, several rows back, the outline of a hairdo, the glimmer of glasses. I stared. "Darling, did you hear me?" Yes. "What are you singing?" "Camelot." "Lovely. Go ahead, Alan," she yelled. The music began, and miraculously, so did I. "A law was made a distant moon ago here. July and August cannot be too hot. And there's a..." I got three lines in, blanked, and stopped singing. Oh, well, that's the end of that, I thought. "Oh, you're a tenor," she cried. I saw the head of hair stand. She moved briskly down the aisle toward the stage. She seemed excited. She was small, well-dressed. She had a lovely scarf and a huge grin. "Did you bring any other music?" "No." "Well, that's okay. Have you got nice legs?" "What?" "John?" The boy with the fiery hair was at my side. "This is John, my assistant." He nodded at me. "Fabulous voice," he whispered. "Mrs. Priest likes you." "Darling, would you mind throwing on a pair of gym shorts and let me have a gander at your legs?" I shrugged and mumbled something assenting, but embarrassed. She said, It's part of the story, honey. One of the characters has lovely gams, wears a toga. I'm sure yours are great. I just need to have a quick look." John handed me a pair of gym shorts and pointed. "Last door up right." "What? Where?" "Wing 3, off up right," he pointed again. I followed the general direction of his finger. I found the door to a small room and returned with bare legs and stockinged feet. "Turn around once, darling, will you, please?" I spun. They gazed. It was oddly intoxicating. Attention, eyes coming at you, lingering on you. The ham in me was definitely pleased. The drama lady, that's how I thought of her now, came to the edge of the stage. "Sing something else for me, darling, anything you know." "Without music?" "Yeah, a cappella." I saw the boy at the piano stand and lean in. I really don't know much except church stuff or..." "Oh, something, honey. You must know something. Whatever comes into your mind." "Okay." The floor of the stage was slatted, varnished, and beautiful. I stared down at the swirling grains of wood, clutched the hems of the gym shorts that I was wearing, and sang the first song, my mom's favorite, that she played over and over again, the first song that came into my head. "Will I ever find the boy in my mind? The one who is my ideal. Maybe he's a dream, and yet..." "What show's that from?" the piano player asked when I'd finished. "That's not from a show," John said. "That's from life." When I first stepped on stage before an audience, a bundle of nerves wrapped in a toga, I could scarcely believe it was my own body. Right on cue, a voice resounded. Whose throat is that? And the limbs attached to the trunk I called Martin instantly inhabited a character named Hero and his bumbling love for the girl next door. I felt myself rise up and lean into the presence, the touch of all those human eyes and ears. It was a lightness of being, a momentary pardon for all the secrets and sins. They were smiling out there. They weren't seeing a bad or damaged kid, so it seemed. They saw, I think, a kid with rouge all over his cheeks, red dots in the corners of his eyes, and a mouth open wide, belting high notes as if his life depended on it. And what I saw written across the field of faces was rapture, I think, a collective delight. How astonishing it was to stumble upon such genuine life while at the business of pretending. And there was something familiar about it all, something church. The huge auditorium, though it didn't have the flying buttresses and jutting steeples of a basilica, had the grandeur of a space built for mortal communion and prayer. Though I was dressed for a silly musical, I couldn't help feeling a bit the altar boy in front of the congregation. Different costume, different stage, but a ritual nonetheless. In the coming years, I would come to think of theater, when it's good, as a place of epiphany. Not the transformation of the body of Christ, but of everybody present. Humans fused by a jolt of laughter, by the thread of a story. And from this very first experience of Forum, I felt, even in all the irreverence, in all the courtesans chasing pseudolus, in all the raunchy jokes, that there was something sacred. A celebration of what's human and what's here. I stood there, an essentially ex-Catholic, uncovering a new faith. And when the curtain call arrived, I bent my head, my body, into the praise and felt no quarrel with living. And the voice in my head said, "This is joy. Remember this. This exists." Thanks, guys. Thank you. Thanks for listening. Yes, so just a little snapshot of, I just felt, as I say, I felt like reading that. I haven't read it or looked at it in a long, long time just because of being here where I began to study and fall in love and, you know, more and deeply and more seriously with the theater. And strange to be just, you know, continuing to do it right across the street at the Strand. Have you guys seen that? Have you all seen the Strand, the new Strand Theater? It's just gorgeous. Well, have you had a chance to be in there? It's new. Yeah, you live in L.A. Say, have you seen it, Richard?
I remember the old Strand.
Yeah, it was.
It was a movie theater,
right? I heard about it. It's infamous. People said it was very like sticky floor.
Pretty, yeah. Films there.
Yeah.
Under the disguise of art films, and I was kind of surprised it came back. It was quite the place.
Yeah, it's amazing. It's an amazing building structure, but they fixed it up so beautifully. And it's got quite a history, I guess, both as you say, as a movie house, playing classic films and porn.
Yeah. And it had a ballet studio up top.
Oh, really?
And from Market, you could look up there and you saw these ingenues there practicing their moves. It was quite interesting. It was a beautiful facade of Market Street at that point from Civic Center.
Oh my God, yeah, I guess bad. Because you know, up there now on the top couple floors, there's a beautiful black box theater. So they have the windows blocked off, I think, because of the theater being up there. They call it the roof theater, I think, something. The students use it a lot. It's a beautiful space. But they've done just a beautiful job with it. I think it's just catching on. You know, they're having trouble getting audiences and so on. So, the Strand, yeah. Well, there's I think ACT, their subscribers and so on, their base is, you know, generally I think a little more conservative, classic crowd. And they're, I think, so they were telling me that many of them are reluctant to come down to this part of town, you know? But, you know, that's just, but it's an amazing building.
It's such a great space.
Yeah, it's so beautiful, yeah, so. Well, I wanted to jump, I'll read a little bit from the second book. I was trying to think what to, I think I want to read maybe just a little passage about my brother David. It's the book is dedicated to my brother David, And the first book is dedicated to my parents and my husband, Henry. And this one, my little brother, I lost my little brother in, we lost him in 2009. And he was a guy, he was an amazing kid, that young man who struggled a lot with anger, which is, I think, why I chose to write about him through the book. But he, many parts of him were revealed to me, even after his death, in writings that he'd given, but that he had written in journals and so on. And but this is a little story about one of the times that I visited him while he was still alive. And so just a taste of David Francis Moran, whose spirit infuses part of the book. And I should say, by the way, that All the Rage, some people have often asked about it, in some ways, it is a kind of response to the tricky part. A lot of people, I talk about this in the play Across the Street, a lot of people asked after the tricky part, which has a sort of Zen meditative forgiveness quality about it, why aren't you more angry, or where is the anger? And All the Rage began to be sort of this imperative to responding to that question, because it obsessed me. It began to obsess me of thinking particularly that maybe I skipped the anger part and jumped too quickly to forgiveness. So the book is a kind of, it is a prism of these many different angles of what is the function of anger in human life, and the dance between this, us knowing at any given moment that we are all in this together, and yet the sense of anger and separation, this fracturing and this coming together, this fracturing and this coming together. And my brother is one window into that. And but this is just one little story about one of the last times I visited him. And he lived up in the mountains in the Colorado Rockies, beautiful spot. His name was David, right, as I say. Dave and I were walking on a road near his cabin in Fraser, Colorado. This was the third, maybe the fourth time I'd traveled there. We just had dinner and were in good spirits. There were often long silences between us, months, sometimes without a word or a call. But when we'd find each other again after a year or two, sometimes three, there was usually a burst of joy, and my sweet brother, who could be so somber and angry and silent, would open like a book full of secret tales. "So yeah," he said, "I was on my way to the doctor's. I had an appointment down in Denver. I made good time on the trip down to the city, so I decided to stop at REI. You know that big sports store?" A bright moon lit the dirt road where we walked. It was early spring. Patches of snow were still scattered about and gleaming at the bases of pine trees. There was a wild racket of what I thought were crickets emanating from the woods. Dave walked slowly, cigarette in hand, occasionally scratching his thick beard between puffs. "So, Mart, you remember how big that store is? Well, they've got great sales and great cheap stuff and all this equipment. I wanted to look at maybe buying a new sleeping bag. Anyway, I parked in the lot, got out of the truck, and I started to walk toward the store when suddenly I knew something was wrong, really wrong. I felt a pain, a kind of rough thud in my chest, and a weird feeling in my arm, and I got right away what was up. I turned around to get back in the truck to drive myself to the emergency room. I wasn't that far from Denver General. Well, damn it if I hadn't left my keys in the ignition. And, of course, it was locked. Too little blood going to the brain, I guess. So I had to crawl through the back of the truck and then through the rear window of the cab. I squeezed in, I'd done this before, you know, and started the damn thing and drove to the hospital. There were parking places on the street. I probably should have pulled over right there, but I knew if I didn't die, I'd be there for a while, and so I'd better get the long-term parking garage. "You're kidding me," I said. He said, "Nope." I said, "I can't believe your presence of mind." He said, "Presence of poverty, man. I hated the thought that if I came out alive, my truck would be towed, and I'd have a whopping ticket. Too much to bear, man." "Why didn't you call someone?" He took a drag from his Marlboro, gave me a quick grin, bright and sharp in the lunar light. "So," he continued, "I parked and walked into the emergency room, and I said to the nurse, 'Hi, I'm having a heart attack.' How did she know to take you seriously?" "Oh, she knew. She knew that I knew. I must have looked like hell. I flashed my medic alert bracelet, and you know, I know hospitals. I gave her my basic info, and in like seconds, they had me on the table in some side room, and I remember the fluorescent lights and commotion, but next thing I knew, I woke up with this stint in my heart. Stint? Stent, I guess, stent, after a short stint in Denver General. It sounds harrowing, Dave. I don't know. Par for the course, me being diabetic and all these years, you know, he said and shrugged. Do you ever call anyone? Not till after it all happened. Jesus, Dave. I sipped the last of my Sierra Nevada pale ale as we trudged along. Dave always made sure to have some in his fridge when I came to visit. He knew it was my favorite. He was an unfailingly sweet host. We walked north on Crooked Creek Road, the insistent singing rising from the woods and ponds around us. All was quiet but for the crunch of our steps. I was trying to imagine life in his shoes, trying to envisage driving myself to the emergency room while knowing I was having a heart attack, parking the truck, talking to the nurse. What was it like, little brother, to be negotiating all of this alone? Alone. So, he began again. Those fucking nurses and doctors were fast once I got there, man. They saved me. Saved me for now, anyway. But what? I asked. He shrugged and took another deep suck off his Marlboro. I winced. Like match to gasoline, my dear friend Ken, a doctor, had said to me when I asked him about Dave's lifelong diabetes and cigarettes. But what? I asked again. Well, the writing is on the wall, man. He looked to the sky, the milky sky, and blew a stream of smoke. We walked. On the far side of the wide meadow before us, across the train tracks where Union Pacific cars clattered and whistled their way through the valley several times a day, the craggy wall of the Continental Divide rose up. Granite backbone of the country, Steinbeck called it. It was etched against the star-filled sky. The Big Dipper and Polaris hung right there before us, clear as bells. At one point, Dave swept his cigarette from one end of the valley to the other and said, "You see this place, bro? This place is just one big hug from God." "The crickets are singing like mad," I said. "Oh, that's the hum of love you're hearing, brother. Not crickets, but little frogs. Wood frogs, peepers." "Peepers?" "Yep, it's spring. They know. Slightest rise in temp, and they rise from the dead, literally. They're basically frozen all winter. They can stop their heartbeat for like weeks at a time. Bizarre, huh? They have some kind of internal antifreeze and hang out there more dead than alive just below the surface. But come spring, it takes them like a day to defrost. And guess what's on their mind? Well, yep, hooking up. That's what the racket is. They wake up looking for love," he said, sounding like the sweet philosopher he often was. "I guess we all have that in common," he said. "You got anyone right now, Dave?" And we walked and walked. He shrugged. "Well, there was a girl from Granby, but nah, she was crazy. Not anyone, not now." "Hey, look," he said. "What?" "Just this, dude." He pointed to his foot as he stepped forward. His white sneaker glowed. "Look," he said, as he took another step. "That's all we can do." His legs moved with a kind of measured pace now, as if willing time to slacken. "And this," he said again, as his foot crunched on the gravel and lifted. "It's all there is." He took another step and another. "All we can do is, like, be here, man." He moved forward again. "And here," he repeated. "And here. And here." His voice trailed off as we walked northward, side by side in the glow of night, encircled by the insistent song of want. Thanks. Thank you, guys. Sweet little thing. Yeah, just a little taste of Brother Dave. Hey, I wonder if we could pause for a sec. I was thinking there might be one other passage I might read, but I'm wondering, I want to check in with you guys and see if you have any, you know, thoughts or questions. I know some of you have seen the play versions of these. And hi, welcome. I'm Marty. Hey there.
Just stopping by to see what's going on.
Yeah. Yeah, no, you got it. Just welcome for stopping by or leaving or whatever you so please. But, yeah, Karen.
I have a question.
Yeah.
You read that passage in the very beginning from Dogen.
Yes, yes, from Dogen.
To study the way is to study the self.
To study self is to forget the self. To forget the self is to allow the 10,000 things to flow.
Yeah. Are you a Buddhist? Or have you studied?
Yeah.
And how is, I mean, say, obviously it's influenced your work and your how you approach acting, but if you could talk about that.
Well, it's definitely, you know, I think all the years of Catholic upbringing has made me leery of like ritual and any organizational religion, though I still feel a kind of affection in some ways for the Catholic Church and so on. But I do go regularly to a Zendo in New York. And I like the sight. I just love to sit silently mostly. And I found more and more I'm leery again of organization, so but I have found great comfort in the Buddhist outlook of sort of just the letting go of the self of no self, the sense of one large mind, you know, and the practice essentially, that just the basic practice of quieting the mind down and attempting anyway to be present with this breath, this room, this gathering, this moment. And that has become much more my practice for me. And you know, it's interesting how it feels tied in some ways to the rituals I experienced as a kid. The prayer and the sense of prayerfulness and meditation that I sort of was imbued with growing up as a Catholic, I think. But Buddhist thought and going to the Zendo and the Buddhist community has certainly had a huge influence on me, and it particularly in the second book, All the Rage, it comes up quite a bit. There are passages that weave in these notions of the mystery and just living, you know, being okay about living in the unknown, you know, that we just, you know, we don't know, and the impermanence of all, you know, like my brother Dave, just poof, you know, and all of us, we die. So are you a Buddhist?
Yes. Dogen is one of my most important teachers, but I'm just curious, one other thing. Which Zendo do you go to?
It's called the Zen Center for Contemplative Care on 23rd Street. And in fitting with this room, the LGBTQ, it's the two monks are Chodo and Koshin, and they are a gay couple.
Oh, that's cool.
And they are, you know, married, and they run the Zendo. Hey, Jim. And they their engagement in the community is hospice work is their main work that they do. But then they run the center, which is dedicated mainly to meditation and so on.
Well, one thing I just want to mention, every Wednesday, over 4 years, we had a meditation group in this room.
Really?
Which I started, and you know, the attendance is really high. Often there are 30 people, you know, weekly sitting in here, just for a short 12 to 12:30, but the room is very peaceful, and so.
Is that still happening?
Yes.
What days of the week?
It's every Wednesday at noon. It's just from 12 to 12:30, so people can squeeze it into their busy lives.
Yeah.
You know, it's a lunch break kind of thing, but it's got instructions.
Yeah.
You know, periods of quiet, periods of just a few words.
Yeah.
But, anyway.
It is a beautiful room to do it in. And I have found meditation more and more in the last few years to be just basically life-saving. The days after this recent election, I didn't know what else to do but try to meditate.
Actually, say what the guy said the first morning.
One of the monks I went to. The Zendo meets regularly on Wednesdays at 6, and everyone, you know, came in for the weekly meditation on Wednesday. That Wednesday after the Tuesday, and you know, everyone said, he took one look at me, one of the monks, Chodo, and he said, "Well, who knew we would have such an amazing opportunity for practice?" And I thought, well, there's one way to look at it, you know, just to have to be forced to practice, really, or be, I mean, or I'll, you know, we're all feeling insane, really, or just, and it's very, very challenging not to get gripped by worry, at the mind going, and so to just practice, anyway, going to a place of, you know, still taking action and showing up and doing what we can, but have to have a place of essential trust in the ultimate consciousness of our sapient creatures, of sentient creatures, that we're still moving somewhere. The long arc of things is very hard, isn't it? It's been hard to read the news. It's been hard to read. So meditation is, I found even more in the last month, has just been vital, an opportunity for practice. You'd say, you know, I'm just gonna, you know, because the mind is just going, right? It's like, but yeah, so. Yeah, sure. What a beautiful room.
You remember that old saying, it's better to be sane in an insane world than insane in the same world.
Yeah. I mean, there is that feeling that the at moments that the only act really, the best thing you can do is just try to stay calm and be present. Hold the door for someone, just be sane. Be sane and around the, because it's the deepest gift perhaps that we can give is just our presence, our whole presence. Breathing and being where our feet are, and you know, it's a challenge. I mean, I'm falling off all that. I lost my iPhone yesterday and it's like so insane. It's been such an profound lesson all day. I've been thinking, what is this panic? I'm disconnected. Well, what is the panic? You know, I was just trying to, I mean, it's deep. It's like, well, what if I hurt somebody's feelings about not texting them back? And what if I miss a message and blah, blah, blah. And it's like, here we are. We're present. I have food. We're warm. We're in this beautiful room. I mean, it's insane. Talk about insane. I'm insane. I lost my frickin' iPhone. So I'm just, you know, it's really something.
But your whole life has migrated into it. It feels like that.
Well, it does feel like that. And then that's an interesting thing to observe.
Yeah.
Like, literally, I recognize a profoundly addictive feeling. It's like, it's unbelievable. I'm really feeling, I mean, it's interesting to speak about because it's very present in the moment. I'm in panic about this device. And I'm traveling, and what if, and what if, and... breathing. We're breathing. But it's really interesting. I spent an hour and a half at the iPhone store, at the Apple store, and the whole time I kept breathing, thinking, just observe this. And, well, what if we do the verification code? What if we find the, you know, anyway. And I thought, wow, this is in Union Square and devices and Apple and capitalism and you know, and I just kept kind of seeing through it to the sunlight and the noises and thinking, maybe I just won't get another phone for a while. Oh, yeah, right. It would be amazing. Yeah, it is intriguing because it has migrated into, and it's part of our being present also in our work and so on. So,
whew. You would have to talk to the people who are right there, you know.
Yeah, imagine.
Everyone being looking down.
Yeah, it's true, yeah.
Can I, if you're done with it, ask you a little bit about
sure.
your writing?
Sure, absolutely.
I have had the good fortune of reading the tricky part, and I don't know if this, I'm going to have to sort of meander through this question, I think. And it really stayed with me in an incredibly powerful way. I think your writing is beautiful.
Thank you.
The thing that's interesting to me is it was much more than autobiography. Your ability to observe in detail things around you. I remember tiny details of, you know, of the color of someone's hair or their skin or something that was going on in the moment that made me feel that you have this great power as a novelist beyond memoir, beyond, you know, autobiography. And you also have a way of having moments that in and of themselves may be random. To give them a really nice character arc, as you have in the readings that you have given us today, where there is a beginning and a middle and an end, and there's something that I can take from it, very specific, and which is very satisfying, I think, as a reader. So I one part of my guess is, have you ever played with the idea, are you at all interested in writing something that is, you know, maybe quite autobiographical, but also fictionalizing it, because you really transcend, again, in my mind, just being someone who writes memoirs. It's much, much more than that.
Mm. Thank you for that. That observation, I appreciate it. And I actually, for the first time, I am now in the midst of writing a play, but not a solo play like the plays across the street, but a 7-character play about an Irish Catholic family. I recognize how many, autobiographical things are bubbling up in certain ways, are fueling the world of the play. It's an Irish Catholic family, and that was, and I thought, you know, and I kept thinking, God, I why is this coming up? But what I am finding is that there is a great liberation and moments of joy in just having permission to make up stuff a lot. Just make it up. And yet understanding and feeling how it's grounded in experience, the river of experience, in the same way memoir is, but it's like wanting to arrive at the same kernels of truth, capital, but with far more fabrication, far more, you know, fictional. So I am in the midst of that, and I'm finding it really hard. I find it really tricky to plot, to just say, to like make it up and then believe in it.
Right.
Say, oh, this happened and this happened and this happened. And then to just hold a belief in the making up of the what happened. You know, it's interesting, I know we have a documentary filmmaker here, and there's a sense of the both artifice, not fiction, but artifice meeting reality, where how you place things together or what you take out in and of itself has elements of fiction, you know, because of the way you create a story.
Exactly.
Recreate it.
I'm going to the emotional truth.
The emotional truth,
yeah. I'm manipulating things out of order, you know, or choosing to focus on one character versus one human, I mean, living character versus another. It's about what the emotional truth was that I was observing. So
yeah.
It's my emotional truth, but it's not any kind of a real universal truth. Like, maybe, I don't know how to do that. Even a documentary.
Yeah. It's your. Yeah, from your spirit, your point of view. Yeah, but it's all that this endeavor to want to offer a creation, whether from memoir or fiction. But I am finding that I'm wondering if I'm through with memoir, but I don't know. I don't know.
You know, I just again I just think you know, you think deeply, you're smart, but you write beautifully, you're very observational, and all those things
together.
I'm quite intrigued with the fact that you are writing a play now, although I love the tricky part, so it's not that I don't love it.
No,
I guess one other tiny part of it was, you were raised Catholic, and you talk about that in so many ways, in, you know, your one-man shows and in the memoir, and there is a part of that is that's about guilt, and you know, and it's interesting to me, and yet you're a very honest person about these experiences and about your own failings and your own vulnerability. And I just, again, I don't know how this is posed as a question, but I just wonder how you have moved through things that have happened that you maybe inappropriately took responsibility for, or you felt guilt for, and how have you found a way as a writer to be so incredibly honest? Do you have any little censoring thing on your shoulder that you have to slap off occasionally, or is it something that you just in some way found a way to just go to truth, whether you look heroic or you don't look heroic in it?
Well, I
does
think
that make sense?
Yeah, it does. I mean, I think the critic, the slapping, you know, the is just pervasive, is always there. And it's odd, not in any aggrandizing way, but do you know that feeling in your gut that grips you like an imperative, that the desire to connect with others with a kernel of some glimpse of the mystery and energy of existence, of being here, that the desire to honor that calling, as the nuns might say, or to honor, in some way has won out. I mean, it's a daily, moment by moment calling to have the courage, is the word, and to endure the shame, to endure the failings, to endure even, I wish the book were better, or I wish the play were better, or I wish I really knew what the truth of that was. But underneath it is this feeling, which I am going to dare to call love, that the desire to love, to be part of a reminder that we are in this together, all 7 billion of us and all sentient beings, you know. And somehow the writing is the form that's taken. So the critic is there and the ego is there. But I've been grateful. I've had spiritual teachers and therapists who've really helped me to understand ultimately that it's not me at all. That the real job is not, I have something to say. The real job is, please let me be available for what is knocking to come through. And then too, it may fail and it may do, but it's just trying not to own it so much. Like, own it in the, you show up and you let it come and you do. But always there's that weird paradox, is it's you, but it's not at all you. It's like a book about Marty, but it's just energy. It's just words that have an architecture that create an energy, and maybe someone reads it and it unlocks something, and maybe that's all that I mysteriously could channel into the world in some way and shift some energy for three people or one person or myself. And so So it's an ongoing dance with the ego and letting go of the ego and not owning any of it, including this body, which is going to die soon, who knows?
Reincarnation, I just think you would have been an amazing priest. I sort of get it all now.
You get it. I mean, I think, people have said about the plays, I've had a lot of clergy come to the plays and they'd say, that's a very priestly work. And I'm like, wow, that's interesting.
That makes a lot of sense.
I mean, all those years of Jesuit school, I don't know, there was a way. And you read Teilhard de Chardin, or you read St. Augustine, or you read, these guys, and you just think, they were basically mystics. Yeah. And they happened to be Catholic. But they're not all Catholic. There was, and then many other mystics in other disciplines. But it just happened that I was born into that deep pool where, having been diddled as a kid, to put it, wasn't just, I was diddled as a kid, and yeah, that happens sometimes in this culture. It was, oh my God, I have met the devil, and I have chosen the devil, and I am the devil. And that weird collision as a kid is in fact the exercise of my life, has become the exercise of my life of understanding, no, What is devil and what is good and evil? What is it? It's life. It's energy. It's please let yourself off the hook. Get to love. Get like all this bashing of the self. I mean, God, the voices. We're so difficult on ourselves, aren't we?
Like Catholicism kind of makes sex so special later in life because you're going against all the things that were bad. It made it kind of interesting. I kind of value my whole sexuality to my Catholic upbringing. I don't think I would have been as sexual if it wasn't for my, Catholicism.
That's interesting. But it wouldn't have felt as sort of this, as much sort of importance around that energy. You mean? Because the Catholicism provided a kind of holiness about it, or sacredness, or? Yeah.
And you felt such guilt, and it was nice undoing that guilt and accepting, later part of your life, and accepting it as a part of life,
as the
being
pleasure.
Okay with it.
Yeah.
But having to break down all those barriers and all that, the evil connotations that
right.
You know, I remember as a child, you know, masturbating as a kid, and then promising God that I would never do it again.
Yeah.
And just to forgive me this one time, and then, you know, 4 hours later, I'd be doing the same thing. I couldn't, you know,
yeah.
But I would be so.
Yeah. It's loaded. I know, it's so loaded.
I'm trying to think of that for you being raised a Jew and me being raised whatever, no religion.
I know, I feel like Jewish people, I have no idea, but my sense is that the corporeal or the corporal is...
It's much more just a part of it.
Yeah, it's just like I have a body, you know?
Yeah.
I'm a hunk of meat with spirit, you know? Or
I mean, of course, there's
but,
different aspects of Judaism. You can be really super orthodox and have a different experience than someone who's not.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah. So
it's very different, yeah. But I relate very much to what Richard said too. I mean, I think there's a way in which it's heightened and I would say that it's only in the latter part of my life that I've begun to unlock the joy and pleasure of saying, "Oh my God, I'm in a body and it's fabulous." It's not something to be the body is less than. It's that odd split they call, I don't know where it goes back to, they call it the Manichaean split or some big theological split years ago of the body and the spirit. And that the spirit is elevated and the body is somehow the thing against which we fight. Maybe a fear of the savage, a fear of death, a fear of, some people have said a fear of the feminine. I mean that in the earliest days, the feminine was, you know, was God. Because like, how else are you? It's like, women, you know, we come from women. And, you know, why are we so afraid of the feminine? And we're working out a lot of stuff, we sapiens, you know, say, but.
So, like, the play is a slim little thing, and then which comes first?
Well, it's been a combo. The tricky part, I was far along with the book, and then the play, a visual element emerged. Mm-hmm. And of course the play is, you know, like 28 pages and the book is 300 pages.
Yeah.
So they're the same territory, but this is definitely structured as to create an event, mm-hmm. like a communal event. These are much more, you think about somebody sitting in a chair, having an intimate.
But you have to decide what to put in and what to leave out.
Yes, the telling omission, as they say, you know, a lot in a play. But all the rage, definitely more the play preceded the mm-hmm. book. Tricky part, the book it more preceded the play, though the plays both opened off Broadway prior to the books coming out. They both took me longer, the books, to write. But it's been interesting to write in both forms, in the spoken and then the literary form, you know. But I definitely learn a lot from speaking them out loud and talking to them, you know. So, I sort of had a. How are we doing on time? I think, you know, we might wind down a bit. Were there any other pressing questions? Hi, Jim.
Well, it's not pressing, but it sort of follows what we were talking about. Because in both the theatrical presentations, you come. It's very. What do I want to say? You engage with the audience immediately in the quotidian and then segue into the play. And after I left last night, I thought, well, what's the difference between storytelling and acting in this? So in the writing of the books, you're telling, you're recounting episodes. And then as you perform it, what is your relationship to the material?
Well, you're talking about as a performer, as an actor,
right.
So to speak, that it, there's definitely a very different relationship to the material in the book, because there is much more a devotion in both, all works, there's a devotion to sentences and words. I love language, and I want, but the language in both plays is crafted to be much more, I have a sense of it's just being made up on the spot. It's off the cuff. And that is a form of storytelling, I'd say, that has to do with somebody showing up and saying, hey, we're like around the campfire and I'm just spinning this tale. And I want to tell you this thing that I saw over the mountain or something. Let me tell you about this. So my relationship to that, the material, is very much about the work or the job, I would say, of being as present as I can be as a human being in the room with the other people and receiving, as I am now, I hope, and we are with each other, receiving the souls in the room in the moment. This moment lived together through the questions of off-the-cuff language. It's a kind of storytelling. This is much more, there's, you know, the storyteller's there, and my voice is in the books, certainly. But there, my relationship is, it does feel very different in that they, it, you know, it just really is meant to be tossed away and read off there, some without the presence of the actor there embodying the events. So
also, have the plays been performed by other actors?
Yes.
Oh, they have?
Yeah. Tricky part quite a bit all over the world.
Wow.
All the Rage? Not yet, yet. I mean, it may, I get reports a lot. It's kind of fun and sweet that both, from both plays particularly, many, many, you know, there's all these monologue kids have to try out for things in high schools and college and stuff. And they're both, I've been told, by many teachers, are extremely popular with young people, young men particularly, to do sections of them for auditions and for contests and stuff. But the tricky part, I get a statement from Dramatist Play Services like every 6 months or so, and you know, and it's just, I said, oh, they did it in Australia, and oh, Iowa, for 4 nights in Iowa, that's interesting. I have. I went to South Africa, and there was a young actor there. He was wonderful, and he did the play. It's tricky. It's hard to see other people do it.
I can't imagine seeing someone else do it.
Well, I'll say, you know, this is interesting. I didn't realize why it was so hard until I was talking to my husband Henry about it a little bit. But I have this amazing director, Seth Barish, who's helped me with the two plays tremendously. And he is so good about constantly reminding me that the story itself is enough, and that the, you know, and so just, we're just there, and that the presence, the lightness of touch is so important, because otherwise it's like bum, 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 bum. So the problem I found, with all due respect, because, and I happened to see another fella who did it out west, and it's this, that from the moment it starts, it's so serious. And yes, I was abused, and you know, and I get it. I mean, it is a hard story. Poor, but the thing that makes the plays live is that at their core, when I walk on stage, and Seth and I talk about this all the time, what I'm walking on stage, like when you tell a joke at the dinner table, you're aiming for that wonderful punchline. And the wonderful punchline of the tricky part is, do you know I was sitting in the car and I had this amazing realization of grace, grace. And that's where it's headed. It's not like, come live, relive this terrible tale with me. It's, oh my God, this is so paradoxical and confusing, but let me try to share this mystery, this grace. All the Rage, the same thing, you know, like, oh my God, I have this dream. But before I tell you, let me tell you all these pieces, but I gotta get to the dream. Oh, but you know, this happened first and this happened first. Oh, and that, but then the dream. Look at this. So it's like one long journey to a punchline, so that Seth's image all the time is point, point. But he's, and then he has a language for it when I start to freight, when I start, this is important, this is important. And what happens after 80 minutes, we're all completely exhausted. Because I've made everything important. I've made everything heavy. And it's really interesting over the course of performing them through the years that it's taken me a long time to understand what he means. And I feel like at the ripe age of 56, I'm I finally, you know, sort of get it. I feel, I hope, the joy of storytelling, and that there's this gem you want to offer, and it isn't bum, 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 bum. It's, wow, mystery. And so then this happened, you know. So, did I answer your question? Yeah. So, and then some. Okay. Well, I think you guys, that we can, anything else? Yes, Richard. Yeah.
I haven't read the books, but I was at both performances yesterday, and you read then and now. And the thing that, you know, triggers a bit of me is when you were describing your stepmom smoking.
Yeah.
And your brother smoking. And it reminded me of the 30s black and white Hollywood films and the romanticizing. And your brother and, like, you know, my sister and my father died of lung cancer. Mm. So thank God I don't smoke. I'm just curious, what is your personal life experience? Did you ever smoke, or do you, or?
I did for a wee bit of time. I did, and I went through a period where I smoked marijuana, you know, like in college, you know, and once in a while, it'll still passes by, being from Colorado and being in California, but I'm not a smoker. No, generally, I worry too much about my singing, my voice, which is mostly how I make my living as a musical theater guy.
Listening to you reading, it almost reminded me of Vonnegut or Jack Kerouac, or, you know, Truman Capote, but the way they would write about smoking.
That's interesting.
You know, Noel Coward's another.
Yeah, I hadn't thought about that. Yeah, but I did have a lot of smokers in my life. There's a scene with my father, and I'll be, but you know, where we're driving in a rent-a-car, and it's my rent-a-car, and I'm visiting him in Las Vegas, and he lights up, and I'm like, Dad, it's a rent-a-car, you can't. He says, you know, oh, the frickin' communists, what, do they have cameras? You know, come on. I was like, Dad, please, it gives me a headache. Oh, you'll be fine, you know. So it shows up a lot. You know, I didn't even realize that, you know, but in this book, you'll see, you know, so it comes up a lot. My father was a... Yeah, there's so many things that are bubbly. I actually... Yeah.
So I
found it less
than
romanticized. Yeah. Like,
just sad.
Yeah, it's funny. Well, I understand what you mean, but it's interesting what Richard's saying. I'm just going to, just with this one thing that, we're riding in the car, and Dad's like, Christ, this traffic. And the, when he says, Dad, please, this, the rent-a-car company has asked. It gives me a headache, actually. Can you just wait till we get there? I can't be smoking right before my oil change, he said, referring to his thrice-weekly trip to the clinic, his date with dialysis. He gave me a wink, and the wry glint of him sailed across the car. Amazing how it still showed up, this undying Irish charisma, flashing through a body gone so heavy with defeat. They'll give me hell if they see it or smell it. Dad, they're gonna smell it. Just a few puffs, Tiger. I'll blow it out the window. He cracked it open. I cranked the AC. Smoke filled the car. I didn't actually hate it. The scent had been an element of his presence since I was a kid. A kind of home base, standing outside after church or on the back patio after mowing the lawn. The whiff of fresh grass and Philip Morris defined a Saturday afternoon.
Yeah.